Let's get out of this noise and I'll tell you while we're here. Really, this is my first opportunity to turn the video on this ride. As you can see, the roads are now back up to pre-lockdown levels. The barons have ordered the peasants back to their posts to save the economy and sacrifice themselves. And so here we are. We're beside the junction 3 of the M55, or as we call it, Kirkham Turnoff. Kirkham that way on a road that's mostly Roman going towards Fleetwood. But we are going this way down Bradshaw Lane towards Wheaton. And what a contrast. That's an interesting place in there. I have a pal down in Merseyside. I won't name him because I haven't got his permission to do so. He's an interesting chap. He's an eminent biologist, dealer in militaria, has a show on a vintage radio station. But I know him through bicycles and through the Liverpoolitan Tweed Ride. And he used to work there. And apparently they researched potato diseases and species of potatoes for different climates and conditions around the world. So it was a biological research institute for potatoes. Excellent work. But now, as you can see, it's used for all sorts of different purposes now. So a beautiful little lane, Bradshaw Lane. We're about 10 miles out from home, heading back in a vaguely homeward direction, but I will be meandering. I might go down through the Plumptons instead. Great Plumpton and Little Plumpton, I might take you that way. But I haven't got a whole load of battery, so without very much battery, I'm going to shut up and let you enjoy the lane. Apologies for the wind noise as usual. Apologies also for the noise of the motorway. That's back up to full traffic levels now. It's like the English half-assed version of a lockdown never really happened. Wales and Scotland are still on stay-at-home orders, so look forward to a couple of weeks where there's a spike of deaths in England. Jolly times. I've got my self-ringing bell. I'm riding the 1983 Raleigh Superb. One of my favourite bikes for a decent ride. Quite a stiff breeze. I'm going slowly because I'm going into quite a headwind. We're off-road again. Farm tracks on a 3-speed. Perfectly suitable. Right, I'm out of breath here because I've just come up a sizeable hill. This circular bricks here that's been preserved is the base of Wheaton Windmill. Highest point for a while around. Very windy, so they put the windmill there. And now down to Wheaton Village. Again, excuse the motorway noise. So I'll just show you today's bike before we get on with proceedings further. It's one of my favourite bikes for a decent ride, and it's my 1983, not as old as it looks, Rally Superb. It's one of the last of the line. By 83, Rally had stopped marketing the Superb, which had been... there have been Superbs in the catalogue since the 1920s, but from the late 40s it became the term for the Super Deluxe of any model. So every model in their Roadster range you could buy a standard or a Superb, and the Superb was green and had stainless steel wheels and such like. Now the Superb kind of fizzled out, and then in the mid 70s there was demand for its revival, so it was brought back as a model of its own. But of a slightly lower quality than the originals. Steel chrome wheels and rod brakes it had gone back to, because it was a nostalgia model. By 82 they were phasing out. By 83, and this is November 83 this was made, at least the rear hub was made, the bike is December 83, probably a Christmas bike. By the back end of 83, Rally stopped the production line making the Superb for the British market. And there was still a demand in the mainland, Holland and Denmark particularly, so they carried on making them for those markets on a special production line which had higher quality control than the British bikes. And if a dealer wanted to order a Superb, you could still order it. It would be taken off that line. And you can tell these bikes because, thankfully, they returned to a better quality. They had stainless steel wheels again, with Dutch-made Van Schothorst wheels. And they went to cable-operated alloy brakes and a general improvement in spec. Now, I've backdated this one because I like the earlier look of them. So I've put these classic Pirelli all-steel bicycle transfers back on it again, and they're actually not reproductions, they are part of a set that I found in the back of the old rally dealers when I took over there, among thousands of transfer sets. That paid the rent for a few months on the shop. Anyway, I put all the mud guards on as well, so it's just backdated a little, the various improvements. This has got a drum brake on the front, which I fitted. Sturmey Archer of the early 80s, so it's in period. The cyclometer is temperamental, so I don't trust it for the mileage. And the old style headlamp. You can recognise the later bikes by the square Sturmey Archer headlamp that they had. And for these models, in fact, it moved down to here. So if you've got a little bracket down there. And if you've got alloy cranks like this instead of the old cotter pins, you've got one of the European market bikes. They are my favourite of the Superbs because they have all the advantages of a later frame. They've got all the cable stops, and cable guides. They've got brazed on cable guides, cable stops under here. They've got internal wiring for the dynamo, so they're not as messy with clips and things like that. They've got a plate to mount the carrier, and they come with this carrier as standard. And they've got a plate to mount the prop stand. So again, all places where the frames get scratched by clips and brackets. Just a neater, more integrated design as requested by the European market. If you want to sell bikes there, you've got to spec them like that. So if you find a late rally Superb, grab it, because they are sought after. They're getting more sought after as people realise what they are. Very occasionally you'll find a maroon one. If you find a maroon one in this size, I'll have it. Right, that's enough waffle about rallies. We're nearly 5 minutes now just talking about the bike. I think it's time we got on with the ride. I'm going to keep my mobile phone on here. This is a little map carrier, but it's ideal for my mobile phone under, providing it's in a protective case, which mine is. So, mount up, jacket in the saddlebag now. Let's go. I knew I shouldn't have parked on gravel with damp tyres. That's what that noise was. Picture of a contented man. Now if this was telly, I'd be berated now for continuity, because I seem to be going in the opposite direction I was going before. I am. There were some fast straight roads before, which are not very good for video, so this is the hamlet of Westby, centred around Westby Hall. I haven't boned up on the history of that before this ride, because I didn't think I would be coming around here. I'm sure it was linked with Lytham Hall, not far down the road. Certainly some of the staff from Lytham Hall were housed in the parish of Westby, I know that. Flash. Quite modern, but very nice. A bit of 60s there. Mid-century, sorry. term to use now, apparently. Anything of our era is mid-century. And here we have a favourite little barn. And I'm going to stop and take some pictures there. And we have the delightful Westby House. Not the same as Westby Hall. Absolutely lovely. But we are going another direction. We are pointing the Rally Superb handlebars up this lane towards Little Plumpton and Great Plumpton, otherwise known as the Plumptons. That's the Brooks saddle squeaking. She does when I start and work hard. Little hill this, coming up into Great Plumpton. Maybe 60s. Now there was an old house behind this hedge that a few years ago disappeared, and it's reappeared again in newly built form. Four cottages here now. I should have come here last week before the motorway got back up to full strength. That's the M55 down there making all that noise, which is a tributary motorway to link Blackpool and the Isle Coast to the M6 near Preston. It's just one of these short motorways. And if I might be able Blackpool Tower on the horizon. And this church is at Wheaton. It's the parish church of Wheaton. But like many churches, it's up on the hill, out of the village a little bit. Being a parish church for an agricultural parish, they used to like to put them on the top of a hill, make them the highest thing around. Apart from the windmill, of course, which made money, so that was always the highest point. But the church was always on a high point that could be seen from all the villages in the parish. And importantly, so that the bell could be heard from all the villages in the parish as well. No need for a huge spire when you're on top of a hill. And these trees would have been newly planted, if planted at all, when the church was built. For those interested in such things, it's St. Michael's. Those who know me know that I'm anything but a flag-waving nationalist. But when you're out riding an old rally and you see a nice display of Union flags, it has to be done really, doesn't it? That's the photog right there. And let's face it, they are out here to celebrate the defeat of fascism, so I'm all in favour of that. And more flags outside the primary school, which is next door to the church. Now let's get down into Wheaton, and the battery's getting seriously down, so I think it's going to be a quick look into Wheaton and then I'll have to say goodbye. So here we are back in Wheaton, where we nearly came through early on in the ride. I've been on a big loop around. Wheaton with Priest is its full name. It's a big parish, it encompasses quite a few local villages, Mythop being one of them, and it's very ancient. Been settlements here for a couple of thousand years. When it's mentioned in the Doomsday Book, it is just recently, by that time, in 1066, passed from the Viking warlord, Earl Tostig, that's it, into the hands of the Norman warlord, Roger de Poitou. I'm doing this all off the top of my head here, I don't have any notes. And then by the 1400s, like everything else around here, it had passed into the hands of the Earls of Derby, the Stanleys. And later on into a family called the Jollies, who were the founders of Congregationalism. There was a lovely little pub called the Eagle and Child, which is named after the motif of the Earls of Stanley, so there are a few Eagle and Childs around here. So let's go and have a look. I've parked by this busily charging I3 here, outside of the Eagle and Child, which is now masquerading as the Eagle at Wheaton, but it is the old Eagle and Child. It's 1575 it dates back to. And there is a mounting block out front, apparently, that's from 1700s and is listed, but I can't see it. But this is probably the old centre of the village. No history about it. I can't find any history about it. Must look harder. So now I'm going that way, heading back. So I'm going to say goodbye to you now. It's become traditional to say stay safe at the end of these videos. But I do mean it, stay safe. And the best public safety advice is ignore everything the government say and follow Nicola Sturgeon instead. But please do stay safe, enjoy being able to get your bike out without being shamed by people. And I'll see you very soon. Bye bye. Okay, rally students, what's this? It is a Triumph, 1950s, with rally forks, rod brakes, 1960s swept wing chain guard, so maybe it's 60s, and a Dutch transport feats carrier, and a nice matte sage green paint job over what looks to be the original dark green. It still could yield a pair of Westwood rims. Spares.